Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, meanwhile, invites President Marcos to visit Canada next year. Trudeau extended the invite during their meeting in Jakarta as the Philippines and Canada celebrate 75 years of diplomatic ties. Marcos sees the visit as an opportunity to deepen ties between Manila and Ottawa and meet with the Filipino-Canadian community. Marcos is also planning to visit three U.S. cities in November for the APEC summit. A meeting with tech companies in Silicon Valley is also in the works. The president also plans to visit Hawaii, as well as Los Angeles or Seattle, to meet Filipino communities there. During the meeting between Marcos and Trudeau, the Philippine flag was displayed upside down, signifying the country at war. But the Foreign Affairs Department calls the blunder an honest mistake. Aside from Marcos and Trudeau, several Philippine officials and staff were present during the meeting. It remains unclear why the gaffe was not corrected shortly before the meeting. The Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. meets with U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris on the sidelines of the ASEAN summit in Indonesia. According to the White House, the two leaders spoke Tuesday, highlighting the strength of the bilateral ties between Manila and Washington. They discussed maritime security in the South China Sea and reviewed opportunities for maritime cooperation with like-minded partners. The U.S. also reaffirmed its ironclad alliance commitment to the Philippines. During the ASEAN summit, Marcos said the U.S. is an indispensable partner of the regional bloc. He also hoped deeper ties with Washington would help ASEAN in its pursuit of lasting peace. Prior to his meeting with Harris, Marcos issued strong statements during the regional meet condemning the militarization of the South China Sea. He also emphasized the need for a code of conduct in the strategic waterway. Katrina Domingo reports.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. repeatedly took a jab at China's illegal activities in the South China Sea in several ASEAN meetings, with the Filipino leaders saying that the regional bloc must take action already to ensure stability in the South China Sea.
We must never allow the international peaceful order to be subjected to the forces of might applied for a hegemonic ambition.
The president did not directly mention China, but he also repeatedly thanked the U.S., Japan, and South Korea for releasing the so-called Spirit of Camp David statement, which rebuked China's dangerous and aggressive behavior in the strategic waterway.
The Philippines firmly rejects misleading narratives that frame the disputes in the South China Sea solely through the lens of strategic competition between two powerful countries. This not only denies us our independence and our agency, but it also disregards our own legitimate interests. We share concerns on the militarization of reclaimed features, the dangerous use of Coast Guard and maritime militia vessels, and other coercive activities. We are equally alarmed by the illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing which are being detected.
During the ASEAN-China summit, the president underscored that the code of conduct in the South China Sea should be based on international law.
We must emphasize that practical cooperation in the maritime domain can only flourish with an enabling environment of regional peace, security, stability, anchored in international law. The Philippines, therefore, continues to uphold the primacy of the 1982 UN Convention under the Law of the Sea as the framework within which all activities in the seas and oceans are conducted.
The president adds that it's time to operationalize the ASEAN Defense Minister's Guidelines for Maritime Interaction, which will provide details on how Southeast Asian navies can work together to uphold ASEAN's interests in the South China Sea and other bodies of water in the region.
We cannot emphasize enough that actions, not words, should be the ultimate measure of our commitment to securing peace and stability in the South China Sea. Anything else simply does not suffice. History will ultimately judge whether the supremacy of the rule of law prevails, ushering in an era where all nations truly stand as equals, independent and unswayed by any single outside power.
Meanwhile, Chinese Premier Li Qiang claimed that China has been working with ASEAN to maintain regional stability.
We have been committed to treating each other with sincerity, and our political mutual trust has grown deeper. No matter how the international situation evolves, China and ASEAN have maintained close exchanges and communication, respected each other's development path.
His statements, however, do not seem to reflect reality. Last week, several countries criticized China's 10-dash-line map, which depicts that nearly the entire South China Sea belongs to China. In August, tensions in the region flared anew after Chinese Coast Guard ships used a water cannon against Philippine resupply vessels within the Philippines' exclusive economic zone. All eyes now on ASEAN to see if the regional bloc will unanimously agree to condemn China's aggression in the South China Sea in its official statement. It's not just regional tensions, but the crisis in Myanmar was also mentioned. Speaking at the ASEAN-US summit, Vice President Kamala Harris says the U.S. is committed to end the horrific violence in Myanmar.
And I am pleased that our collective vision for the Indo-Pacific is in strong alignment. We have a shared commitment to international rules and norms, and to our partnership on pressing national and regional issues such as the crisis in Myanmar.
Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News, Jakarta, Indonesia.
President Marcos coming home from Jakarta with $22 million worth of investment pledges from top Indonesian companies. The commitments cover the fields of digital connectivity, artificial intelligence, and animal health. The bulk of the investment pledge comes from PTWIR Asia, TBK, a company that develops augmented reality technology integrated with virtual reality and AI. Marcos also witnessed the signing of several memorandum of understanding between the business advisory councils of ASEAN members on agriculture cooperation and small business development. A Philippine Senate panel reviews the confidential and intelligence funds of government agencies. Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri, who heads the Oversight Committee, says 28 agencies are under evaluation to see if they properly utilize their confidential funds for 2022 and 2023.
Katulad yan, meron kaming listahan itong taon ng mga ahensya ng gobyerno may confidential intelligence funds. We're going to come up with a report. We will have to review it all. Then we have to come up with a report. Tama ba pang gastos nila dito? Dapat ba tanggalin dito sa kanila, bawasan, or kailangan ba dagdagan?
The review comes amid heated budget deliberations in Congress. The Office of the Vice President and the Education Department are taking the spotlight after being questioned for requesting huge confidential funds, despite being a civilian agency.
The point I'm driving at and the reason why I'm asking for this, Madam Chair, is to disabuse the thought of the people that confidential funds is a secret fund. Hindi naman ito pwedeng gastusin sa gusto lang gastusin ng DepEd Secretary. There are specific rules as to where this can be spent, how this can be spent, and to disabuse the mind of people that this is like a secret fund, it is not. Secret yung submission na expenditure, but there are only specific items you can spend it on.
Hanggang ngayon, hindi malinaw kung paano gagamitin ng DepEd ang napakalaki na confidential budget na ito, na mas malaki pa sa confidential fund ng mismong DND. Let's set our priorities straight and ensure that not a single peso in public funds is wasted on vague and or counterproductive measures.
The Senate targets to finish the review by mid-November. The Philippine Health Department facing a 3% budget cut for 2024. The proposed budget for the DOH is at 311 billion pesos, with more than half of it going to the Office of the Secretary. Several specialty hospitals in the country are also facing downsized budgets, with the Philippine Heart Center taking the biggest cut of 1.8 billion pesos. The budget for medical assistance to indigent patients will also be slashed by at least 10 billion pesos.
Nagbawas. In short, bawas din ang servisyo natin.
Hindi naman, these are, NEP levels are the same and the operating expenses are covered. Luckily, we have MIP.
The budget cuts come even if affordable healthcare is one of the president's priorities. But at least one lawmaker believes the Marcos administration should not be blamed for the budget cuts.
Hindi dapat ganito sa DOH. Dapat po ma-restore yung cut. at kaya taasan pa po.
Hindi pa po pwede na meron tayong drama na pinapalabas natin na lahat ng programa ng kalusugan ay tinapyasan and making the administration look back where in fact it is not true.
PhilHealth vows to pay its 27 billion pesos debt to hospitals within 90 days. This comes after the state health insurer was criticized for failing to pay hospitals despite having high investable funds and net income. PhilHealth President and CEO Emmanuel Ledesma says it will implement a debit credit payment mechanism to settle the matter. He adds, they're looking to implement reforms in the company, including raising the number of employees to at least 10,000. The Philippine National Police has formed a task force, a tracker team rather, to actively pursue expelled Congressman Arnolfo Teves Jr. This after a court issued a warrant of arrest against him over the Degamo murder case. The PNP says it is coordinating with the Philippine Justice Department and other government agencies in locating Teves, which will be difficult since he is overseas. They will also be coordinating with the International Criminal Police Organization, or Interpol. Teves and four others were charged with 10 counts of murder and several counts of frustrated and attempted murder over the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Ruel Degamo and nine others in March. Philippine senators criticize the flaw in the country's mandatory SIM registration process. This comes after the Philippine Investigation Bureau presented before the Senate how easy it was to fool the system with an ID using a picture of a monkey. A Philippine telecom company says this is possible since they don't have access to IDs issued by the government due to data privacy.
Pero unggoy yung nasa picture eh. Hindi po namin nakikita yon kasi diretso po sa system. Pero eventually po, meron po kaming validation process. Meron pong selfie. Kung sino nagre-register sa selfie po yan. Tapos meron pong government ID dapat supposedly na i-represent.
Senator Grace Poe, meanwhile, is seeking to amend the implementing rules and regulations of the law. Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri and Senate Majority Leader Joel Villanueva, meanwhile, want better processes to handle complaints on the SIM registration system.
What we have now is not really sufficient. So we will have to go back to the drawing board and probably with the cooperation of the NTC, ma'am, maybe we can amend the IRR, no?
NTC, kunyari po, ay emailed contratexcam@ntc.gov.ph. We filed the complaint August 14, Madam Chair. Hanggang ngayon po, walang action taken. It's almost 3 weeks na din po